Hi there, I'm Andreas Marazis, host of the ENC podcast, and this is the ENC In Depth. Today's in-depth discussion is dedicated to the rise of militaristic sentiment and patriotic discourses in Armenia, Azerbaijan, Russia, and Turkey. And it is part of ENC's series of podcast discussions with experts and academics, assessing the developments in the Eastern Partnership area in the fields of security, foreign policy, economy, democracy, and education. Today we have with us two distinguished speakers. On my right, we have Dr. Sergey Rumyansev, if I pronounce it correctly.
Yeah, it's okay.
Who is the co-founder of the Center for Independent Social Research based in Berlin. And to my far right, we have Dr. Andrey Devyatkov, I'm sorry about that, who is senior researcher at the Center for Post-Soviet Studies of the Institute of Economics of the Russian Academy of Sciences and associate professor of the Department of Regional Problems of World Politics at Lomonosov Moscow State University. So today's topic is part of a broader report entitled Visions and Strategies for Conflict Transformation, Dominant and Alternative Discourses on Gender, Militarism and Peace Processes, of which Sergey will speak more in detail in a bit. So Andrey and Sergey, welcome to ENC In Depth and thank you for being here with us today. Let me start our discussion today by asking you, Sergey, first to tell us a few words about the report itself and the project behind it.
Thank you for the invitation first. And okay, about the project, this is not the first project, and we started a couple of years ago to develop our online journal. This is the Journal of Conflict Transformation, as you see it here. Mostly it was focused on South Caucasus, but couple of years ago we decided to include also Turkey and Russia and Ukraine, because as you know, the escalation and conflicts now appeared also in all these countries. And the main idea which is behind of the project, this is to bring together professionals from all these conflicted country, and especially from the countries which are at the moment in the conflict, like for instance Azerbaijan and Armenia, or Ukraine and Russia, and do something together, let's say. So previously all the peaceful building projects or some kind of these projects were mostly like, if we are sitting at the same table, then we publish something, you know, everyone from his own perspective. Then that's what we may achieve. But we decided that if we are professionals, we can do something really together from the same level, from the same position. And the idea that, for instance, Azerbaijani, Armenian, and Turkey or Russia, from Russia, experts and political analysts, researchers, can focus on the same problems and try to analyze the situation from the same position. So constructing some kind of atmosphere of the confidence between these people who are included into the project, and representing some, even if it's not about the new ideas, but representing some kind of a new level of discussions, let's say. And producing some kind of a new discourses, which may be not really opposite, but different from the official discourse, which are, we believe, mostly very militaristic and conflict. So this last project we are talking now about, this project was conducted by Imagine Center for Conflict Transformation, which was registered in Tbilisi, and maybe this is the only one organization which unite people from Armenia, Azerbaijan. Firstly, it was founded like that, and then Georgians, Turkey analysts, and from Russia also, our guests from Russia and Ukraine were also joined us. And this last project was conducted with a partnership with the Center for Independent Social Research in Germany. This is the new organization was founded only 2 years ago, but at the same time, there is a long story behind it, because it was first mostly with the same, almost with the same title. It was established in St. Petersburg.
Mm-hmm.
So now it's 25 years, one of the most, mm-hmm. one of the oldest NGO in Russia. And this center was became a foreign agent in Russia. So we decided to support this center also. That was also the behind of the idea to establish the center also in Berlin. And was supported by the Federal Foreign Office of Germany, and also IFA Institute in Germany with a civic program.
Mm-hmm.
That's maybe.
Maybe you can very briefly also tell us like what's the purpose of this project in the end of the day, and the length of the project, and if you also plan to have more reports coming out. I mean, so as what we expect in terms of deliverables from this project.
Yeah, this is our second issue,
mm-hmm.
let's say, and of course we are going to continue. We are continuing anyway, mm-hmm. so we try to find different approaches how to represent this idea. So mm-hmm. somehow it's also multimedia with videos, with a lot of photos, more journalistic, let's say, mm-hmm. level. Another approach to make it more analytical, and of course this paper issues. These are two first paper issues. These are more analytical,
mm-hmm.
Focused on some very problematic situations. And for the future, of course, we are going to continue also with the civic program and Federal Foreign Office of Germany. Try to find support from every part we have, and we are also supported by the US embassies in mm-hmm. Soskakodos, in Armenia, Azerbaijan, and Georgia. And what about this specific issue, if I can say a
yes.
couple of words about that?
Yes, of course.
We decided to make some kind of a, maybe for the future, also to think about some permanent chapters, kind of permanent chapters, mm-hmm. parts mm-hmm. of our publication. And one of the first step for that, this is about conflict, militarism, and politics. So make some kind of, provide some kind of analytical reviews on the very sharp mm-hmm. problems and some new tendencies appeared in the region. So that was the idea, to focus on the rise of militaristic sentiments, because as we see now, this more or less new conflict between Russia and Ukraine, and in Ukraine itself also, unfortunately, and another escalation in Turkey, mm-hmm. which is also quite new tendency, and of course the April war between so-called April War, mm-hmm. let's say, four-day April War. Maybe
we'll get to
that later.
We'll get to
yeah.
that, because I think that Andrey
yeah.
is waiting for us. Mm-hmm. And I would like to give the floor actually to you right now. Maybe we can get actually to the chapter itself, and you can tell us a little bit about the methodology, like the scope behind this specific chapter, what kind of methods you use, like in your research and so on, in your approach.
So in my chapter, actually, I focused on Russian public opinion, so on how Russians actually are viewing the current events mm-hmm. around Ukraine, around Syria. So the main methodology for me was, of course, to look at statistical data, at sociological surveys. Mm-hmm. And of course, the main issue, the main problem to tackle these surveys is how you interpret them.
Mm-hmm.
So I collected the information from all possible agencies which are state affiliated with the state, or which claim themselves to be independent. So and I collected all the data, and it was actually the main methodology was also, of course, not simply sociological surveys, but also discursive analysis, just to try to review all the data and to put them into some scheme how we should interpret the current views of Russian people on and how militaristic this they can be. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Well, maybe this is a question that you can both actually answer. Is based on your research and the data that you collected for this chapter. Can you tell me what has changed in the South Caucasus, but also in the Black Sea region itself, the last few years? We had the crisis in Ukraine, we have the so-called war in between Armenia and Azerbaijan in April 2016. So what are the new tendencies, old conflicts coming again, the current situation? So please give me like, give us like a taste of what is happening right now.
So my feeling is, so probably I start just a mm-hmm. couple of words because I'm a political scientist and this mm-hmm. is probably the question which I can answer, mm-hmm. Really. So I'm not an anthropologist or sociologist, so because many from our group, from the authors of mm-hmm. this are actually sociologists or anthropologists, and me, I am more a political scientist, specialist on international relations. So I think that in today's conflicts in Syria or in Ukraine, we don't have the so-called modus vivendi. So we don't have some kind of status quo. So we don't know what will happen tomorrow. And this is actually the greatest challenge for the international security. I speak not about only Russia, I speak about security situation in general. Mm-hmm. We don't know the concrete red lines for all sides taking part in these conflicts. For instance, now we don't know whether a reunified Syria is possible at all, so the so-called political settlement of the conflict. Because now all the sides, I mean US, Russia, Turkey and Iran, are working on a common settlement. But of course many problems still remain on the ground and of course politically in the relations between all the states there are some misunderstandings and problems. And that's why we don't know how all these countries are really controlling the situation on the ground, because all of them are supporting some political forces in Syria. But how controllable these forces are. The same in Ukraine. We have some kind of a security line between DNR, LNR on one side and Ukraine on the other side. And we have some in Kyiv, for instance, we have many people striving for a revanche against DNR and LNR. But this self-proclaimed republic are also striving for status quo, but they are losing their power because they don't have enough soldiers, etc., etc. Russia is also paying now more attention not to Ukraine but to Syria and to internal situation in Russia itself. Mm-hmm. So we don't know what will happen tomorrow. So but nevertheless, we also have some issues in U.S. politics, yes, because we have on the one side Trump, who is paying attention more to North Korea, Iran, to other issues, and we have on the other side Pentagon. Special forces, etc., which are paying attention more to Russia and they are trying to produce some kind of negative sentiments towards Russia. So and that's why some new sanctions can come out, which will destroy all the modus vivendi, which is probably appearing in the region. Mm-hmm. So this is how I can actually identify the situation in the region.
Okay. Sergey, can we have also your input on that?
Yeah, what I think, what is important that we see that how every new conflict or every new circle of escalation influenced more deeply on the neighbor countries. Mm-hmm. As we see, for instance, the new revolution in Ukraine influenced on the relationships between Russia and Ukraine, and not only, but also somehow influenced also on the South Caucasus. Or struggle in Syria also influenced on the rises of militaristic discourses and sentiments in Russia. Mm-hmm. So make more popular these army, representing the army from the more positive, let's say, with the more positive ideas. And what about, for instance, South Caucasus and Black Sea region itself? This so-called new war between Armenia and Azerbaijan, unfortunately, we were expecting for such kind of escalation for the years. And it was like, you know, every part of the conflict, which are not only Armenia or Azerbaijan, but also, of course, Russia and somehow Turkey and who else, they were talking about possibility of that. Mm-hmm. But, you know, it was only until it was only the discussions about the possible escalation, especially if we are talking about in terms of the war, we still have a possibility to avoid it. But now, unfortunately, there is such an experience of the new war. Mm-hmm. So let's say that it will be much easier to start the second, the third war, mm-hmm. Because this new generation of people who were born in these countries after that first war in the beginning of 90s, now they have this experience. And for instance, what changed, for instance, in Azerbaijan and Armenia, that was the very destructive change in these countries. And this is not only about the raises of militaristic sentiments, but this is also about the never-ending growing of the military budgets, mm-hmm. Never-ending growing of the ideology of revanchistic ideology, mm-hmm. and this is also about the changes of some kind of mobilization strategies, mm-hmm. in these countries. So, for instance, now in Azerbaijan, this new discourse about this four-day war in April, this is the discourse about our triumph. Mm-hmm. So if we more or less lose the first war, then the second war. And of course, in Armenia, it finished with the idea of one nation, one army. So let's say if this second war, as it was represented from the authorities' side, mm-hmm. should have to bring us somehow nearer to the resolution. Mm-hmm. On the other way around, I think it took us on the longer distance, mm-hmm. from that, mm-hmm. unfortunately. And we see these new rituals, you know, these funeral ceremonies of grooming these soldiers who were killed during this war. And we see this idea of one army, one state, and triumph. And what we also may expect and we may observe now, that how these militaristic sentiments support these oligarchic and authoritarian regimes in this country. So they found the new resources for supporting their position.
And one of the elements I would add also, like, of increasing these militaristic sentiments is also the information. Information like the governments in these countries, they are informing the public, I mean, the source information, if they're like Russian or if they're like local ones. I mean, I think it's more bestly described in another chapter, I think, in this report about the impact of media, and it's something that we will discuss later on. But it's very important, the fact that you take into consideration the, I mean, you're moving the conflict from the political level to, like, the social level, let's say, mm-hmm. how the people are affected, how they are, I mean, how the grievances are basically retained in these countries, and so on. Now, I would like to maybe move the discussion and finish it at this point with you, Andrey. And I would like you to give me the perspective of the Russian population. Like, do the Russians want war? And maybe this rings a bell because it refers to an old Soviet song. So, please.
You mentioned very well. So the song from 1961, it was a song about how the Soviet people have remembered the victims of the Second World War, and that's why they did not want a war. So this was actually the main idea. And of course, now people don't, in Russia, they don't remember very well the victims of the Second World War and even of war in Afghanistan and Chechnya. So we now have a new generation, completely a couple of new generations in Russia, which grew up without a real war.
Mm-hmm.
And it's, of course, is affecting how people are really talking and how they're interpreting the war and the warfare. And of course, but on they are very, and on the other side, they are very dependent on the media coverage. And how the events are portrayed by the official media, first of all. But by looking at the surveys, I also indicated that there is some kind of a, we can use also the so-called bottom-up approach, that the people, they still have, despite of media coverage, negative media coverage, etc., the people still have some preferences,
mm-hmm.
And the war is not the main preference at all. So how the sociological surveys show, people would like to see Russia as a secure and peaceful country,
mm-hmm.
Which should provide for its own people well-being, wealth, etc., etc. So people are more aware now of socio-economic agenda, because after 2014 we suffered a little from the sanctions, of course, but the main factor why socio-economic stagnation is going on now in Russia, that it's the decrease of oil prices. And of course, the well-being of people is decreasing, and this is the authorities should take it into consideration and correcting its policy a little bit. Mm-hmm. And if we are looking at media coverage, we can indicate that Ukraine is not anymore an issue for official media, for TV stations, etc. So now we are looking at Ukraine more as a negative example of what Orange Revolution can bring into the country. So we are not observing anymore the media coverage about Donbas, etc., etc. So more attention is now paid to how Russian weapons are used in Syria and how can be then after that sold to on the international markets to other countries. So that we are making, together with the US, a war against terrorism, and that we are with the United States at the same level in global politics,
mm-hmm.
so that other great powers take care of our position and respect our positions in Syria, in political settlement in Syria. So I think that this so-called Crimean syndrome is actually over. So to 70%, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
So, and that we are now returning to some extent to normality. That
mm-hmm.
people are more. Of course, we have many, people radicalized during this last 2 or 3 years. But actually, 1 week ago or a month ago, we had a story with a Russian boy from Nizhny Urengoy presenting at Bundestag, at German parliament, on the Second World War.
Mm-hmm.
And after that, because he just mentioned that we don't need any war anymore, and etc., etc., he was attacked by some representatives of Russian public. But the authorities clearly expressed their position that this boy should not be attacked because of that. So that he said that the Germans also suffered from the war. Yeah. So we now have a situation when both the majority of the people and the authorities are facing a red line, yeah, which they should not cross.
Mm-hmm.
So that and now during the pre-electoral period, of course the authorities, the president, are talking much about geopolitics, about security issues, but discourse of development, discourse of some reforms, of some reformist agenda,
mm-hmm.
has returned to Russian official discourse, and I really welcome that.
Okay. Well, on this note, I would like to thank you, both of you, for your contribution and for being here with us today. That was very valuable. And I would like to inform our audience that there will be a series of podcasts dedicated on this report, because it's a lengthy one. It's 250 pages, if I'm not mistaken. So there will be a couple of more podcasts focused on different chapters of this report. That was the ENC In Depth. And I'm Andreas Marazis. Thank you very much.